हेलो स्टूडेंट्स एंड अ वेरी गुड मॉर्निंग टू यू स्टूडेंट्स. एज वी आर डिस्कसिंग चैप्टर 6 ऑफ क्लास 8 साइंस, दैट इज़ कंजर्वेशन ऑफ बायोडाइवर्सिटी, एंड दिस इज़ द सेकेंड पार्ट ऑफ दिस चैप्टर. इन प्रीवियस पार्ट ऑफ दिस चैप्टर वी हैव स्टडीड अबाउट बायोडाइवर्सिटी एंड कॉजेज ऑफ इट्स लॉस, कॉजेज एंड कॉन्सिक्वेंसेज ऑफ डिफॉरेस्टेशन एंड स्टेप्स टू रिड्यूस डिफॉरेस्टेशन. नाउ इन दिस पार्ट we will study about flora and fauna, endemic, extinct and endangered species, red data book, and at last we will discuss about protected areas, about national parks, wildlife sanctuaries and biosphere reserves. So let's start with the first topic of this part, that is flora and fauna. What are flora and fauna? So first of all we will discuss about flora. What is flora? The different plants that grow in a particular area is called flora. In any particular area, the different varieties of plant grow, and these different varieties of plant that grow in that particular area, in that particular region, is called flora of that region or flora of that area. As for example, trees of mango, jamun, pine, oak, deodar, bamboo, etc., they form the flora of Himachal Pradesh. Means these are the trees, they are present, they are found in Himachal Pradesh. So collectively they are called as the flora of Himachal Pradesh. As we can take the another example also, suppose the trees of Dhak, Sal, Arjun, Ber, etc., they are present, they are found in Rajasthan, so they form the flora of Rajasthan. Now, next we will discuss about fauna. So, what is fauna? Just like the flora, the animals which are found in a particular area, in a particular region, all the variety of animals which are found there, it forms the fauna of that particular area. As for example, animals like tiger, leopard, antelope, sambar, chinkara, nilgai, porcupine, hyena, wild boar, etc., they represent the fauna of Rajasthan. Means these are the animals, they are found in Rajasthan, so they are found in the different regions of Rajasthan, so they form the fauna of Rajasthan. Now, next thing, the spheres of Earth. We know that the area near the surface of Earth, it can be divided into four interconnected spheres, and these spheres are lithosphere, hydrosphere, biosphere and atmosphere. Lithosphere, you all know that the solid rocky crust which covers the entire planet, which covers the entire Earth, that rocky part is called lithosphere. Hydrosphere, it is made up of water, and all that water bodies which covers the Earth, that is called hydrosphere. Biosphere, it is very prominent sphere of the Earth. Why? Because this is the part which supports the life, or where the living organism presents, or where the living organism exists. So that sphere is called biosphere. Actually, biosphere includes the land, that is the lithosphere, water means hydrosphere, and air means atmosphere. So all these three spheres, they come under biosphere, because all these three spheres, that is lithosphere, hydrosphere and atmosphere, they support the life forms. And atmosphere, this is the body of air which surrounds our planet Earth. So these are the four spheres of Earth. One more thing, students, we have studied about ecosystem also in our previous classes. So you know that the ecosystem, it includes the all living organisms, means all living organisms like plants, animals and microorganisms, which are found in the spheres, different spheres of Earth. and their non-living component also. So living organisms means plants, animals and microorganisms along with their non-living component means the climate, the soil, carbon dioxide, oxygen, nitrogen. So they form the ecosystem of any area. So this is a system which include living organisms and their non-living components. Next is endemic species. What are endemic species? The species of plants and animals which are found exclusively in a particular geographical area. Means some plants and animals are there, the species are there which are found in some particular geographical region only and nowhere else in the world, and such species are called endemic species. As for example, giant panda, it is found in mountains of Southeast China. Asiatic lion, it is found in Gir National Park, Gujarat. Then Nilgiri tar, it is found in Nilgiri Hills. Lion-tailed macaque, it is found in Southwest India. So these are the endemic species. They are found in these particular regions only and nowhere else in the world. That is why they are termed as endemic species. Now, what is the reason why endemic species form? Why these animals are not found everywhere? So, some factors are there which leads to the formation of endemic species. Why any species become endemic? Why any species restricted to any particular area only? So, some factors are there. As first factor is destruction of habitat. It is possible that the habitat is destroyed. That is why they are confined to a particular region only. Then climatic changes. Because of the climatic changes also, it is possible that the rest part of the world have lost such species. And the most important reason, the most important factor is the increasing population of the species. It is possible that the population of the species has increased, or introduction of new species also which compete with the endemic species and they are confined to a particular geographical area. So these are the factors which lead to the formation of endemic species. Now, extinct species. Extinct species, the species of plants and animals which have been lost forever are called extinct species. Means these species of animals or plants, they are lost forever. They will not come back. So such animal species or some plants, such plant species, they are called extinct species. And now they are represented by fossils only. Means they are not left on the earth. So some examples are dinosaurs, Archaeopteryx, dodo bird, Nilgiri holly and cry pansy. These two are the plants, Nilgiri holly and cry pansy. So dinosaurs and Archaeopteryx, they become extinct due to drastic climate change during the course of evolution on the earth. Dodo bird, it became extinct in the year 1680s from Mauritius due to habitat loss. And one more reason is there, because of excessive hunting by humans. This is means the poaching. This is also biggest reason of the loss of biodiversity. And these two plants also, Nilgiri holly and cry pansy, they are also the extinct species. Now the next species is endangered species. So endangered species are the species which are at high risk of becoming extinct. Means they are at the borderline, they are reduced, their number is reduced to very few, and very soon, if the same conditions, if the same causative factors continue, which leads to their extinction, so these species will become extinct very soon. So such species are called endangered species, which are reduced to very few in number, and they are at very high risk of becoming extinct. So their examples are Indian rhinoceros, Asiatic lion, crocodiles, blue whale, Bengal tiger, snow leopard, etc. These are the species of these are the endangered species. Now, Red Data Book, it is a source of book. It keeps the record of all endangered species, and means all endangered plants and animals. So first of all, this Red Data Book, it was published by the IUCN, that is International Union for Conservation of Nature and Natural Resources. So first it was published by IUCN. This is the International Union for Conservation of Nature and Natural Resources. Now it is known as World Conservation Union, that is WCU. Now, what is the aim of IUCN or WCU to publish this book? Because this book keeps a record of endangered species too, so the main aim of IUCN or WCU is to focus the attention of conservationists towards species that are endangered and they are at high risk of extinction so that they can be conserved. Now, next species is vulnerable species. Vulnerable species are the species which are likely to move to the endangered category in near future. Means those who are not in endangered category, but if the causative factors continue to operate, if the same factors which can lead to make them endangered, if these factors continue to operate, so in that case these species will move to the endangered category. So such species which are likely to move to the endangered category in near future, these species are called vulnerable species. As for example, chinkara, black buck, golden langur, etc. These are the vulnerable species. Now, protected areas. Now, next topic of this chapter is protected areas. Protected areas are actually, these are the undisturbed areas or undisturbed habitats for wildlife. These areas are created or they are made under Wildlife Protection Act 1972 by Indian government in order to protect biodiversity or means flora and fauna with their habitat. So according to World Conservation Union, protected areas are the areas which are dedicated to the protection and maintenance of biodiversity along with their natural and cultural resources. So these areas, they protect and maintain the biodiversity along with their natural and cultural resources. Now, protected areas include national park, wildlife sanctuaries, and biosphere reserves. So first protected area that we will discuss is national park. National park is an area which is strictly reserved for the protection of wildlife. It preserves flora and fauna and natural environment of that particular area, and if any historic objects are present, so national park preserves that historic objects also. So it is quite possible when you will visit any national park, surely you will get some historic objects also. You can get some temples or you can get some historic monuments also. So national parks, they are meant to preserve flora, fauna, their natural environment and historic object. Means they restore, they maintain the cultural heritage of that particular area also. Now, activities like grazing, hunting, forestry and cultivation, these are banned, totally banned in national park, and no any private ownership is allowed. Now, at present, there are 104 existing national parks in India. Very soon, it become 106 because two new national parks, that is Dehing Patkai and Ramona National Parks, they are going to be added in Assam. Now these are the list of some Indian national parks. First of all, you can see Jim Corbett National Park. This national park, it is located in Uttarakhand, and its old name is Halley National Park. And first of all, it was established in 1936. So this is the first national park of India. The first national park of India is Jim Corbett National Park, whose old name is Halley National Park, and it was established in 1936. Some other national parks is Dudhwa National Park. It is present in Uttar Pradesh near Lucknow. Then Ranthambore National Park, it is in Rajasthan. Kanha National Park, it is in Madhya Pradesh. Simlipal National Park, it is in Orissa. Now you can see this image. This is the image of Kabul Lamjaw National Park. This is very important and very famous because this is the world's only floating national park, and it is present in Manipur. It is in Manipur, India. That is why it is very important. Now, next protected area is wildlife sanctuary. Wildlife sanctuaries are the areas which are reserved for protection of animals only. So these areas, they are meant to protect animals only. The killing, capturing of animals, these activities are strictly prohibited in these areas. But some activities are allowed, as harvesting of timber and collection of minor forest products. These areas are allowed in that much extent only. That is, these activities, they do not affect the wildlife. In that case only, these activities are allowed. Now, in India, there are 566 existing wildlife sanctuaries are there. Out of 566, I have taken some example as Gir Wildlife Sanctuary. This is in Gujarat. Then Sultanpur Bird Sanctuary. This is in Haryana. So Dachigram National Sanctuary, it is in Srinagar. Mudumalai Sanctuary, it is in Tamil Nadu. Kaziranga Sanctuary, it is in Assam. It is present in it is famous for one horned rhinoceros. Then Periyar Sanctuary, it is present in Kerala. So these are the examples of some wildlife sanctuaries. Now one more thing, students. Now we can say that if animals are present in that wildlife sanctuary, so they are just like a zoo. But zoo is quite different from wildlife sanctuaries. Means wildlife sanctuaries are different from zoo. Why? Because yes, animals, they are also protected in zoos. They are also protected in wildlife sanctuaries. They are also given food there in zoo also and in wildlife sanctuary also. But in a zoo, animals are kept for public exhibition. They live in artificial environment and they are given food at specific times of the day. But in sanctuary, animals, they live in their natural habitat and obtain food. They get their food from their habitat on their own. By hunting, they can get their food. Or if any herbivores are there, they can get their food by their own. They don't have to wait for their owner to give food. So that is why wildlife sanctuary is different from zoo. Now next protected area is Biosphere Reserve. Biosphere Reserve is a large multi-purpose protected area for conservation of wildlife, plant and animal resources. It is large multi-purpose protected area because it includes wildlife sanctuaries and national parks also in it. So it is meant for the conservation of wildlife, plant and animal resources. One very important thing is there that people are an important component of the biosphere reserve. Okay, means these biosphere reserves, they are developed to permit tribes and other people to live in the area. they maintain the culture of that particular area because they save obviously national parks and biosphere and wildlife sanctuaries are also there, so they preserve that culture of that particular area also, and they obviously they conserve biodiversity, and yes, they maintain ecological balance also. That is why biosphere reserve is a very large multi-purpose protected area. Now these biosphere reserves, they are divided into three zones: core zone, buffer zone and manipulation zone. So core zone is the region where no human activity is permitted, no any human activity is permitted in core zone. Next zone is buffer zone. So buffer zone is the zone where very limited human activity is allowed, and the third zone is manipulation zone. Manipulation zone is the zone or area where various human activities are permitted. So biosphere reserve, it is a large area where national parks and wildlife sanctuaries are also there. At present there are 18 existing biosphere reserves are there in India. So at this time 18 biosphere reserves are there in India. Now let's have a look at some examples of biosphere reserve. As first example is Pachmadi Biosphere Reserve. It is in Madhya Pradesh and it consists of Satpura National Park and Bori and Pachmadi Wildlife Sanctuaries. So under this Pachmadi Biosphere Reserve, one national park, that is Satpura National Park, and two wildlife sanctuaries, that is Bori and Pachmadi Wildlife Sanctuaries, are there. Now Nilgiri Biosphere Reserve. Nilgiri Biosphere Reserve has one national has two national parks, that is Bandipur National Park and Nagarhole National Park. And this Nilgiri Biosphere Reserve was the first biosphere reserve established in India. It was established in 1986, and this is the first biosphere reserve of India, which comprises of two national parks, that is Bandipur National Park and Nagarhole National Park. Now Kanchenjunga Biosphere Reserve, it is in located in Sikkim. This is the largest biosphere reserve in India. And Panna Biosphere Reserve, it is located in Madhya Pradesh. This is the smallest biosphere reserve in India. Now Project Tiger. Project Tiger was launched by Indian government in 1973 to protect the tigers in the country, because day by day the tiger population in India, it has been decreasing sharply over the years. In 1948, population of tiger was about 20,000, which decreased to 4,000 in 1989 and 1,233 in 2000. So realizing this decline, Project Tiger was initiated by the government of India. At present there are 51 tiger reserves in 18 Indian states, and it consists of 2,967 tigers according to census 2019, and it is about 70% of the global tiger population, because India has the largest number of tigers. Now some tiger reserves of India. As first tiger reserve you can see, this is Nagarjun Sagar Srisalam Tiger Reserve. It is present in Andhra Pradesh, and this is the largest tiger reserve of India. Then so many are there. This one, the Jim Corbett National Park. This Jim Corbett National Park, that we have studied, that it is located in Uttarakhand. It is famous for tiger, and it is the this national park, it is the tiger reserve also, because it has the largest number of tigers in India. It has 239 tigers in it. And after that, this Kaziranga also, it is also famous. Yes, it is famous for one horn rhinoceros also, but it also consists of a large number of tigers. So these are some of the examples of tiger reserves in India. Now this chapter is completed. Thank you, students.